It is America's passion. We live for it, hunger for it, cheer for it, and are inspired by it. But it is so much more than a game. We love it on our youth fields, in our high schools, at our colleges, in our stadiums, and on our TVs. But it is so much more than a game. We love those who coach it, play it, broadcast it, and even officiate it. Well, most of the time. But it is so much more than a game. Football is a classroom for commitment. It is a laboratory for learning important life virtues and values like teamwork, perseverance, responsibility, courage, compassion, and character. Life skills that, if mastered, will not only make you a Hall of Famer, but more importantly, a great father or mother, husband or wife, son or daughter, friend, teacher, preacher, soldier, police officer, firefighter, or citizen of our communities. General Douglas MacArthur ordered that a plaque be placed on the playing fields at the United States Military Academy at West Point. It said, "Upon the fields of friendly strife are sown the seeds that on different days, on different fields, shall bear the fruit of victory." Long before they had a master sergeant shouting orders in the heat of battle, those on the sands of Iwo Jima, the beaches of Normandy, in a thousand places with names like Belleau Wood, Heartbreak Ridge, Porkchop Hill, or Fallujah, had a coach teaching them the critical lessons of sacrifice, respect for others, loyalty, duty, honor, nobility, and yes, even love. The huddle is a place of inclusion, where, as Dr. King once dreamed, each man is measured not by the color of their skin, but by the content of their character. On the battlefield, just like on our playing fields, character is measured by the fight for every precious yard, purchased by the sweat, blood, and tears of those young men and women fighting for freedom and against the oppression of others. Football is the only sport where every player needs every teammate on every play just in order to survive. In the 99-year history of the National Football League, there have been more than 1,200 players, coaches, and administrators like Roger Staubach or Pat Tillman, who have interrupted their professional careers to defend our country in battle. Three members of the NFL family received the Congressional Medal of Honor, our nation's highest award for valor. And while all gave some gave all, as 22 members of the NFL family gave what President Lincoln called the last full measure of devotion. One of those men was a 6'6", 250-pound offensive tackle who played for the New York Giants in 1942 and 43, named Al Blozes. The New York Times said that the very size that made him so intimidating on the football field kept him out of the military until late 1943, when after repeated attempts, Blozes finally persuaded the Army to waive his size limitations and accept him. It took further persuading to get him from behind a desk to the front lines. In the fall of 1944, then a second lieutenant in the 28th Infantry Division, nicknamed the Human Howitzer for his ability to throw the discus, the shot put, or a grenade, Lieutenant Blozes left his Army teammates in Germany to join his other teammates, the New York Giants, on a three-week furlough to play three important games. He then returned to his other teammates fighting World War II. On January 21st, 1945, his platoon was in the mountains of France scouting enemy lines. When two of his men, a sergeant and a private, failed to return, Blozes went in search of them, alone. He never returned. The New York Giants retired the number 32 jersey that Al Blozes wore, having proved himself to be one of the greatest teammates and Americans of all time. Al Blozes is not a hero because he played football, but the values he learned in football taught him all he needed to know to be a heroic teammate and an American hero. Players learn quickly that by investing yourself in a community of others and a purpose greater than oneself, you actually become more relevant and not less. And the greatest team you'll ever play on is your family. And football is all about family. At the conclusion of every National Football League game, there is a treasured moment that is rarely, if ever, broadcast. Fans are emptying out of the stadium, but players, coaches, and staff from the opposing teams of different race, creed, and religion gather at midfield, kneel, and hold hands in prayer to thank our Almighty God and pray for those on our playing fields and for those brave souls on our battlefields. Thank God that we have teammates who care about honor, integrity, nobility, and America. It's more than a game. It is so much more than a game.
Good morning. Welcome to our very special presentation for Veterans Day. We like to think that the Pro Football Hall of Fame is the most inspiring place on earth. And for me, each year, I don't think there's any more day that's more inspiring than this one. President Lincoln once said that a nation that does not honor its heroes shall not long endure. And we kind of think that's true of sports as well. Our mission here is to honor the heroes of the game, to preserve its history, to promote its values, and to celebrate excellence everywhere. But as you can see, it's more than a game. It produces young men, young women, that are prepared to go to the other side of the world to fight and, if necessary, die for our freedom. These are real heroes. Every year we gather in this room with all of our gold jackets. There'll be about 130, 140 of them in this room, and they are the greatest names in football that you have ever seen. And every year we have brought back, thanks to Dr. Novelli, several recipients of the Congressional Medal of Honor. And when I introduce those guys, every one of those football heroes get on their feet and they cheer, because they know who the real heroes are. And what's interesting is that our recipients of the Congressional Medal of Honor can't wait to meet those football heroes. You know, for Leroy Petrie, as we were talking last night, he wanted to meet Troy Aikman and Emmitt Smith and Michael Irvin, because he's a Cowboy fan. But we know, and our gold jackets know, who the real heroes are. And this is a different program. Normally this room would be filled and overflowing, and we're streaming it live to the rest of the nation now. But we've only got about 25 people in our room, and we're all masked up, and we've got social distancing to accommodate everything. But we're not going to let any measly pandemic stop us from honoring our heroes. And we have a number of heroes with us. We've got a number of veterans here, as you saw with our color guard. We thank you for all of our veterans that are here. We have Blue Star families and Gold Star families that are here. God bless you. We are deeply thankful because it's not just our soldiers that are in the fight, it's their families that have to endure as well. We've had many recipients of the Congressional Medal of Honor here. Doc Ballard, Leroy Petrie, as I mentioned, Clint Romache, Sergio Garcia, Woody Wilson, who is now 93 years old, I believe. But Dr. Novelli has been a great partner in the Hall of Fame, not only to bring us so that we can honor such men and women of character, but also in the Patriot Project that he founded, that we are deeply in support of, where he has brought together chiropractors from all over the country, all over the world, so that he can work and repair and heal the bodies of those who've gone in harm's way for us. So Dr. Novelli, thank you. But tonight, I want to tell you, you've got a really, really special pleasure in front of you. This is heartfelt, and I will tell you that according to what he told me, I'm 6'9", 400 pounds, he's about 140. But I will tell you without any qualification whatsoever, this is the biggest man I have ever known. In 1 Samuel 16:7, the prophet Samuel went to the house of Jesse, and he was to tell Jesse that one of his sons was to be the next king. And he said, you know, Jesse went and got his biggest son and his oldest son, and Samuel said, it's not he. Then he went and got the next biggest, the next oldest, said, it's not he. And he went through every single one of them. And finally he said, do you not have another? He says, well, I got one more. Not very big. And he's out taking care of all the sheep. And of course, that was King David, the greatest king that Israel had ever known. But Samuel said this, that God measures not as man measures by stature or size, but God measures the heart. I would like to introduce to you a man with an incredible heart. And we have some big people come through here. They are big, they are strong, they are fast. But none of those are quite as big as Corporal Kyle Carpenter from the U.S. Marine Corps.
The man you see before you today, Corporal William Kyle Carpenter, should not be alive today. But we are here because this man, this United States Marine, faced down that terrible explosive power, that unforgiving force, with his own body, willingly and deliberately, to protect a fellow Marine.
In 2010, I deployed with 2nd Battalion, 9th Marines, to Marja, Afghanistan. We were constantly attacked, just like we were every single day for the entire deployment. The fighting was very intense, and it wasn't a matter of, okay, is it gonna happen, but just a matter of when. Myself and an amazing friend and fellow Marine, Lance Corporal Nick Euphrasio, we were on top of that roof together. We were near the end of our 4-hour post position on top of the roof when the enemy initiated a daylight attack with hand grenades. Felt like I got hit really hard in the face. My vision was as if I was looking at a TV with no connection. It was just white and gray static. I thought about my family and how devastated they were going to be, especially my mother, that I didn't make it home from Afghanistan. And I closed my eyes and I faded out of consciousness for what I thought was gonna be my last time on this earth. The medal represents all who have raised their right hand and sworn to give their life, if called upon, for their country. It represents those who have never made it home to receive the thanks and recognition they deserve. Those who charged the beaches in World War II, froze while fighting in Korea, bled out across the lush fields of Vietnam, and those who never made it home because of another deadly blast in the battlefields of Iraq and Afghanistan. Those who were tortured for years in prisoner of war camps, and those who still rest in distant lands, forever remaining, missing in action. The medal represents the parents, husbands, wives, and loved ones who have heard the dreaded knock on their front doors to find a telegram or service member delivering the unbearable news. This is where the true weight of the medal is carried. Being a Medal of Honor recipient is a beautiful burden, but one I am honored to carry.
Kyle, you not only saved your brother in arms, you displayed a heroism in the blink of an eye that will inspire for generations. Valor worthy of our nation's highest military decoration, the Medal of Honor.
Kyle, you're the youngest recipient of the Medal of Honor. You're only the second Marine to have received it since Vietnam. But you're also a football fan. And what was it like when you got the call to come to the hall and represent all of our veterans here today?
First and foremost, thank you all for being here and spending some time with me. And David, thank you for that introduction. As always, your words are powerful and very touching and amazing. I will say that I'm a little upset with them because I'm 145 pounds, not 140, okay? Let's get that straight.
Well, the truth is I'm about 405 pounds, we're even.
Plus or minus a few, but no, and to all the veterans, I want to start out and just say thank you. And thank you will never be enough, but I truly appreciate it. We truly appreciate it. And it's an honor to come after you. And that beautiful path that's laced with sacrifice to not only help make our country what it is today, but to give us that example of just being the best service men and women that we can. So thank you. And to describe what it was like when I got the call to be here today, surreal and extremely humbling. As I told you last night over dinner, I'm still trying to get over my visit from 2 years ago. And so this is gonna take some more time. But as a football fan, as an American person, and just a junior Marine, I still feel like, to be in a place of such history, such honor and integrity, is very powerful. And I'm just so appreciative and again, humbled at this opportunity. And I hope it's the first of many, but hey, I'll take it if it's a once-in-a-lifetime experience, for sure.
That's great. That's great. Well, we're honored to have you here and your dad, Jim. And we really want you to come back to enshrinement, because next year we're going to have twice the fun in 21, and you need to be here for that.
David, I can check my schedule. I think I can make it.
What makes a guy want to fall on a grenade? What is it that in that moment of instantaneous, I was impressed last night at dinner by your compassion for the people you were defending. You told me last night that you, if you could go back and change anything, you wouldn't change it. because of what you've learned on the journey. But what is it that makes a man do something like that?
Well, most importantly, I don't recommend jumping on any grenades if you have the opportunity, okay? I would like to think that it was, you know, well, first and foremost, I think just like in football, the repetitions, the small things that give you that foundation to be successful. That started with my family. Mm. You said my dad's here today. My mom couldn't be here, but she is probably nervously waiting for me to call or text her after I get done. But from the moment I was born, from the moment I woke up in the hospital, my parents and my family have been there every second. When I woke up in the hospital, the only thing that wasn't injured on me was my left ankle. My parents took hours and hours long shifts just keeping their hand on my left ankle to keep me in reality, to keep me from hallucinating, to try to just give me any sense of comfort and peace that they could. And so I'm so thankful because I know everyone doesn't have that foundation and doesn't have an incredible family like me, but knowing that, I'm just so grateful because without them, I would not be sitting here on this stage right now. But also, the other side of that is the Marine Corps is such an incredible organization. From the moment we step on those yellow footprints at Parris Island or Recruiting Depot San Diego, it is ingrained us every single day that the uniform and that cloth that you wear came with a price that is too heavy for words. And it's ingrained us every single day that no Marine is more important or any better than the Marine to the right and left of them. And so, and also throughout boot camp and your time in the Marine Corps, you know, they put it nicely, you know, they wear you down every single day. They're very tough on you. But through that, and in those low moments where you don't know if you can do another push-up, you know, do another rep on the gridiron, in those moments for Marines, they stop and they teach you. And they tell you about the courageous Marines that have come before you. Those Marines that I mentioned in the video that at 17, 18, 19 years old, knowing that they were probably, if they were lucky, going to survive a minute or two after charging onto that beach. Knowing that, they still got out of that landing craft and moved forward, one foot in front of the other, towards that imminent danger and probably death. So to hear all of those examples and stories of those Marines and our history with that foundation, they help us and they make us want to be courageous and want to step up in those times of adversity in the military and even after your service in life.
Kyle, that's a great expression because I think you make me want to be courageous. You are special. It says in Scripture that no greater love has any man than this, than to lay down his life for his friend. And you were prepared to do that. You did that, you know, for someone who I think at the time was your best friend on the roof there with you when that grenade came in to that sandbagged area. But what's fascinating to me is I think that as you went through the next 3 years at Walter Reed Hospital of recovering, that took courage, not only on your part, but on your parents' part, as you mentioned, and your family's part. And they laid down their life to kind of love you back to health. You know, you had so many injuries. I think you had, your arm was shattered in 30 different places. You flatlined 3 times. You had a collapsed lung. You had brain surgery to get shrapnel out. Lost vision in an eye. You are an overachiever, there's no doubt about it. It's incredible. Let's take a look a little bit at when you were sharing some of your injuries and your journeys with Dave Letterman.
If it's all right with you, I'm going to run down the list of injuries you incurred. Is that okay?
Yes, sir.
You're comfortable with that?
Yes, sir. I mean, I'm not hiding from anybody.
Yeah.
So.
Okay. Countless shattered bones throughout the body. Countless, more than a dozen, something like that?
30 in this arm.
30 in one arm.
Yeah. I'm an overachiever.
Shrapnel in both legs, carotid artery in neck, punctured, ladies and gentlemen. Both eardrums ruptured, lost most of his teeth, arm broken in more than 30 places, collapsed right lung, lost most of your jaw. Is that true?
Yes, sir.
Lost most of your jaw.
Well, the almost 3 years I spent in the hospital, much of that time and most of my around 40 surgeries was facial. Pretty much everything from the eyes down is plates and reconstructive surgeries and fun stuff like that.
You look wonderful.
Thank you. Thank you. And that's, you know, I would like to take this opportunity to absolutely credit Walter Reed and the military medicine and the staff there who just do a phenomenal job.
Lost the vision in his right eye. There was brain surgery to remove shrapnel, and he had a fractured skull. And now, like this other stuff is not enough, you flatlined 3 times. In fact, at the scene, they thought you were dead, didn't they?
Yes, sir. Well, when I arrived at Camp Bastion, which was the first combat trauma hospital out of 4 that I went through, I was labeled PEA, which I guess is politically correct way. It stands for patient expired on arrival. But I was not alive.
What was your first moment of cognition after this trauma? How long after the trauma, and what was it?
About 5 weeks later, I woke up, and the first thing I saw was my mom had decorated my room to fit the Christmas holiday, and I saw a stocking for every single one of my family members hung on my hospital wall in front of my bed.
Well, I don't know what to say. I wish you nothing but the best in life.
Thank you so much.
Thank you for your sacrifice. And as a parent, I hope to God my son does not ever have to go through what you have gone through. But in some way, I hope he is able to manifest the same courage.
Thank you so much.
It's a great honor to meet you.
Thank you so much.
Thank you, sir. Corporal Kyle Carpenter, ladies and gentlemen. Your Medal of Honor recipient.
So I went home with the understanding that I would continue surgeries and therapy at home in South Carolina, stay checked in with my doctors and my chain of command at Walter Reed. So I went home. And around 10 o'clock one night, I'd only been home for a couple of weeks. I was still extremely injured, extremely worn down, very medicated. I mean, if this wasn't such a profound moment in my journey, I remember very few things from this time period. But I was sitting at the kitchen counter one night, and I was around 10 o'clock, worn out from therapy like I was every day, and I decided to try to be big, bad, independent me, and with my two busted arms, make a bowl of cereal, which about defeated me just trying to do that. The milk felt like it weighed 100 pounds. I could barely even pour the cereal. I still can't hold utensils right, but I couldn't even hold my spoon really at the time. My mouth was very damaged still. I was missing most of my teeth, all but one on the bottom. And even though I had nerve damage, I could feel that I wasn't a very clean eater in that moment. I could feel milk going everywhere. And I think the frustration from the task, but also that was the first time I had had a moment of quiet in 3 months since really joining the Marine Corps, but since getting injured. There was always doctors in my room, always people visiting. And so that was the first time it was just me, myself, and my own thoughts. And I completely broke down. I think I tried to stay strong and positive for my family every day. And in that moment, it just the weight of everything that had happened, the state that I was in, and the unknown of what lay ahead just completely broke me in two. And my mom rushed in thinking I was in pain, which I probably was, but she was asking me what was wrong. And I simply just looked up at her and I said, "Who is ever gonna love me again?" And at the time, I wish I wouldn't have said it. I hated that I said it because I saw that it tore her into even more than what I was experiencing. And I don't know how I had this insight or how this came about, but I realized in that moment that, you know, in life, in my moment, in all of your moments of those low and hard, difficult times, I realized that you cut out the noise, you cut out everything that's going on, and when it's just you and yourself, you have to realize that you really only have two choices ever. And this is a tough pill to swallow, but you can either sit at that kitchen counter for the rest of your life, or you can get up and take that small step forward. And it might take you a week to heal from whatever you're going through. It might take you every day for the rest of your life. You might be physically, mentally, and emotionally a little different, and that's okay. But even if you don't know where you're going, if you get up, you take that small step, you try to stay positive when you can and keep moving forward, you truly can come out on the other side of your struggles better than when you got knocked down. And that ties in with the marathon. I had never run a marathon before. And to cross that finish line and accomplish an extremely strenuous and difficult task after I had been in the worst shape of my life was a very powerful and beautiful thing. And I'm thankful that I survived and I went through that, so I can tell all of you that with time, just like on the football field, with time, persistence, a good attitude, hard work. You know, I still don't really have a plan and direction of where I'm going, but I've always thought, you know, if I work hard, if I try to be a good person, do the right thing, and again, I just keep taking those small steps, it's got to take me somewhere great. I've got to help some people along the way. And now here we are sitting at the Pro Football Hall of Fame. So keep your head up, and I promise no matter what you're going through, you can get through it. And that would be, I think, my lesson I would want to leave you with.
Wow. For a guy who never thought he'd be loved, I love you, man. I love you lots. I'm excited that you've got a new fiance. You're going to get married a year from now. Because if you weren't, I think my wife would leave me for you, because we love you that much. you know, again, spending last night with you and with your dad, you do just have such a great heart. You're a beautiful man, and you've earned that in a very difficult way through all the challenges you've talked about. I'm convinced that the very best is still ahead for you, and you are going to change a lot of lives because of your words, because of your example. Let me bring to your attention for all of our viewers out there and for all who are with us, this is a new book that was completed just at the end of last year by Kyle. A wonderful title. It says, You Are Worth It, Building a Life Worth Fighting For. We will get copies of this to put them on sale here at the Hall of Fame, but I'm sure you can get it in Amazon and other places. If you want to have a life worth fighting for, this is a man who could share with you how to do that. You know, when we were at dinner last night, you were talking so compassionately about the Afghans, and sometimes, again, in our media here, it's sometimes not very supportive of the military or why we're sending our sons and daughters to fight on the other side of the earth. And I was blown away by the compassion you had for the people that you were defending there and how you felt it was worth it.
I absolutely believe it was worth it, and I will spend the rest of my days thinking that. And you know, those are valid questions and concerns. Sending our sons and daughters into harm's way on the other side of the world to places where most people can't pronounce or don't know where it is on a map. And it's important to note that, one, I would not change 1 second of my journey. Whether that is looking at Afghanistan, joining the Marines, how I got injured, all of that time in the hospital, I wouldn't change 1 second of it because it's led me to where I am today, to who I am today. And second, when I went to Afghanistan and when I joined the Marine Corps, I was hoping just to do something good, to commit myself, my life, now my body, to a greater cause and a greater purpose than myself or any one individual. And so I don't think anyone knows exactly what to expect or can anticipate going into intense combat, especially 7 months to a year of it. But being on the ground over there, you know, there's always big political, convoluted reasons for everything, arguments for everything. And many times, the media, all of you, even boots on the ground that are there, don't know exactly what that big, clear picture is. But being there, boots on the ground every single day, getting shot at all day, every single day, to see how those people lived in a way, and the simplistic lifestyle is beautiful. That was a beautiful aspect of it. But through that beauty and simplistic lifestyle, to wake up every single day of your life, from the time you're born in your mud hut with your family and farm animals until the day you die, to live in fear, to not have freedom of choice, to want to learn how to read, but you're too scared that you're going to be killed, beheaded, stoned to death because of it. That was just almost more than I could comprehend. To talk to the children throughout the villages and for them to ask you, is everywhere in America like Disney World? Can you really turn a knob in a room in your house and get fresh, clean drinking water? To not know that humans have been to space or been to the moon. That, I mean, 10 years later, and that is still almost incomprehensible to me. So with all of that said, not only would I not change anything, but even while I was there, every single night when, I think we got pillows a few months into the 7 months, but every night I lay my head down on that dirt, looking up at the stars, I thought, wow, not only can I not believe I made it through this day today, but am I gonna make it through tomorrow? Is tonight gonna be the last night that I lay my head down on this earth? All of those thoughts, all of those concerns were put to peace. And I was, you know, I didn't want to get shot at, but I was comforted that if and when my time came, if that next day was my last one on this earth, you know, we were there. Whatever the big reasons are, whatever. But we were there just trying to help our struggling, oppressed fellow human beings and people and children that woke up every single day hoping that today's sunrise would be a little bit better and a little more hopeful than the one before. And so I would not change it. I would go back if I had to. And I'm proud of what we did. And also, in a way, the price that I paid and what I went through, because, you know, maybe if I hadn't gone through what I did, I wouldn't feel like I gave my full and best effort as a Marine. And I joined to feel like I made a difference, and I feel like bleeding for my country and having that thought every night, was this my last day on earth? You know, it makes me proud and content with the effort I gave and the effort my fellow Marines gave to just try to, sounds stereotypical, but try to make the world a little bit better place.
America, I submit to you the heart of an American soldier. Is that beautiful or what? Before we leave, we wanted to give the good people here an opportunity to ask any questions that you might have. If you do, please feel free. I think we've got a microphone here somewhere, and feel free to stand up and ask a question of Corporal Carpenter.
And I speak to kindergartners and up, so I'm pretty sure I've heard every question out there, so you're not going to offend me, and anything you want to ask, I'm happy and honored to answer.
Your journey is really about life, and your journey is about surviving and going next day. Honestly, I just like what you say, that all the veterans, I mean, we have 20-plus veterans committing suicide every day. What is your message for them to keep going and keep living? Fight that every day.
Great question.
That is a great question. And to know veterans struggle and those that do take their lives feel that hopeless and lost with no direction is and will always be completely heartbreaking. And my message would be, along with what I said earlier about It's okay if you have bad days. Just always strive to take that small step forward and just keep going, just like you did in the military, just like on those 15, 20 mile hikes where I know that you were wishing that you didn't join like we all were because of how much we were hurting and suffering. Just keep going and keep in mind that those that we lost, the things you experience that you struggle with, the things you've seen and gone through, it can be devastating, it can leave you hopeless at times, but know that their sacrifice was what they signed up for. Just like I wouldn't change my journey, and you know, maybe that in a way is easy for me to say since I survived and that I'm still here. But they raised their right hand. No one made them, and they wanted to serve. They wanted to be a part of that family and that cause. And you have to keep living and you have to keep going for those that didn't make it back and for that very reason. You know, I am speaking today, I am here a lot because I want to, and I enjoy educating people and bridging that gap between civilians and our veterans and military. But I'm also here because as a veteran that, and I know all can't, and it's very difficult to talk about things, but as a veteran that is still here, that can communicate, that can be up here on this stage, I feel a beautiful obligation to do that because I am here. I still have a voice and I made it home. And so I would just encourage veterans who are really struggling, who don't feel like there's a way out, who are surrounded, you know, by darkness in their mind. You're still here. You're alive. And that is a very beautiful and powerful thing. And instead of try to reshape your thinking, instead of looking at the seemingly negative in your eyes, things that happened, you lost friends, maybe you lost limbs, maybe your, you know, brain and thoughts aren't what they used to be because of an injury or because of what you went through. It's okay to struggle, it's okay to go through those things, but instead of focusing on all that, try to search for those silver linings and try to look for the positives. You're still here, you're still breathing. You have time to shed light on those that are not here anymore and that gave, as Lincoln said, that last full measure of devotion. It's all about the silver linings, it's all about perspective, and again, just continuing on even when you don't think you can.
Great question, great answer. Another question, perhaps?
I've got something.
Yes, we've got a microphone here for you, sir. There you go. Oh,
thank you. Kyle read your book.
Thank you.
And it's an incredible book to read. I hope you sell an album for him here at the hall. It's a Mickey Mouse question. Are you still putting the metal in your GoPro box?
I am. I did upgrade slightly, but this is the first time I've used this box. So it's still hanging out in the GoPro box.
I've got something for you. I got this at a Medal of Honor Society meeting, and I'd like for you to have it.
Oh, thank you very much. Oh, that's amazing.
Yeah.
Thank you. I appreciate it.
It'll match.
Yes. It's a little bit more official than a GoPro box. Thank you.
Thank you. Well, it's great to have the box, but it's even a little bit better, I think we could all agree, to have the man to hang it on. And you are an incredible representative for the Marine Corps, for America, for your family, and we are so lucky to have you here. And I'm so excited, not just about the journey you've traveled and what it can teach all of us and how we can learn that from your book and hopefully be inspired, but what's ahead of you? And if I could kind of tack on to your question, sir, about what message it would be for our veterans, I would say come to the Pro Football Hall of Fame. Huddle up here. We love you. We want you to be a part of it. We're working together on having the Warrior Games here, which is for wounded veterans who compete internationally in the Invictus Games. And we're looking at having that here in Canton every other year. And because of things that Dr. Novelli is doing that started right here, we want you to know that the future is far better than the past. And there is great hope that you have saved lives and changed lives. I thought I'd end real quickly here. You made me think about this last night when my wife and I were leaving you and Jim and from dinner. And your journey is inspiring. It is incredible. But I tell you, you're a beautiful guy. You are easy to love. The thoughtfulness that you have reflected on each part of this journey and found meaning in it. But President Reagan used to talk about a guy named Private Martin Tripto. I don't know if you're familiar with him, but he was from World War I, and he was a barber from Cherokee, Iowa, and he was charged with delivering a message from one of the trenches in World War I to another line where there was another trench, and he almost made it when he was cut down by a machine gun. And in securing the message, they also found his journal. And in the journal in the flyleaf, he had written the words, "My pledge." And his pledge was, "America must win this war. Therefore, I will work, I will save, I will sacrifice, I will endure. I will fight cheerfully and do my utmost as if the entire issue of this struggle depended upon me alone." And Kyle, you are a guy who have worked, you've saved, you've sacrificed, you've endured. I can't imagine somebody fighting cheerfully in those circumstances, but if someone does, it's you. And I am thankful that God has raised families like yours to raise men like you to defend our country, to fight the battle that comes after you return for our veterans. We are so blessed to have a man like you wear a medal like that. And I've known several of your comrades, as you know, and you are a great representative of America, the Marine Corps, and the Medal of Honor Society. Ladies and gentlemen, let's all thank Marine Corporal Kyle Carpenter, recipient of the Congressional Medal of Honor.
If we look to the answer as to why for so many years we achieved so much, prospered as no other people on earth, it was because here in this land, we unleashed the energy and individual genius of man to a greater extent than has ever been done before. Freedom and the dignity of the individual have been more available and assured here than in any other place on earth. The price for this freedom at times has been high, but we have never been unwilling to pay that price. Those who say that we're in a time when there are no heroes, they just don't know where to look. the sloping hills of Arlington National Cemetery with its row upon row of simple white markers bearing crosses or stars of David. They add up to only a tiny fraction of the price that has been paid for our freedom. Each one of those markers is a monument to the kind of hero I spoke of earlier. Their lives ended in places called Belleau Wood, the Argonne, Omaha Beach, Salerno, and halfway around the world on Guadalcanal, Tarawa, Porkchop Hill, the Chosin Reservoir, and in 100 rice paddies and jungles of a place called Vietnam. Under one such marker lies a young man, Martin Treptow, who left his job in a small town barbershop in 1917 to go to France with the famed Rainbow Division. There on the Western Front, he was killed trying to carry a message between battalions under heavy artillery fire. We're told that on his body was found a diary. On the flyleaf, under the heading My Pledge, he had written these words: America must win this war. Therefore, I will work, I will save, I will sacrifice, I will endure. I will fight cheerfully and do my utmost as if the issue of the whole struggle depended on me alone. We must realize that no arsenal or no weapon in the arsenals of the world is so formidable as the will and moral courage of free men and women. It is a weapon our adversaries in today's world do not have. It is a weapon that we as Americans do have. Let that be understood by those who practice terrorism and prey upon their neighbors. As for the enemies of freedom, those who are potential adversaries, they will be reminded that peace is the highest aspiration of the American people. We will negotiate for it, sacrifice for it. We will not surrender for it now or ever. We are Americans.